The Inhuman, the reference to the Inhuman is based on some echo of the occasional uses of the concept of the Inhuman by Donna Haraway. Although, as you might know, all of you, some of you, they have never been fully elaborated philosophically. She is referring to this concept in as to a metaphor that she's basing mainly on Lovecraft, the Cthulhu myth. Then, okay, so I am sort of taking this concept and imbuing it with a certain reading inspired by Laruelle. So I'm trying to speak here of the human in non-humanist terms, so not in post-humanist terms, but in non-humanist terms, which is reflecting the methodology of Laruelle and of non-philosophy, is a reflection of. So, and it's not a mere product of certain adherence to a philosophical or theoretical legacy such as non-philosophy. It also has a certain meaning in its own right, this use of the prefix non, which might be analogous but is still independent from that of Laruelle and his use of non-philosophy, of non in the compound noun of non-philosophy. So I am using the non in a rather analogous way, but it still has a history or a theoretical history of its own. So it is also relying on other critiques of humanism, such as post-humanism, mainly feminist critiques, and the use of non with regard to the human is analogous to that of non-philosophy in the sense that I see the human as a purely philosophical construction. Philosophical in Marxist sense, in Laurelian sense, perhaps in Solarcia's sense, and Brassierian sense, and other currently interesting debates of certain withdrawal from the self-sufficiency of philosophy. So this is the basic intro, so that it doesn't come as a sort of a source of initial confusion that I'm combining immediately at the start of this paper, Laruelle and Haraway. And also, what else? Yeah, the radical deed. Since I operate with this concept since the beginning, I should also explain it. So, I establish another analogy here, an analogy between Haraway, her concept of the cyborg, and Laruelle's concept of the human, no, he doesn't use the word non-human. I'm using it on John Mularkey's. He calls it the human inhuman. That would be the radical human, the human without philosophy, without humanism as philosophy, he seeks to conceptualize. So the analogy is the cyborg and the human inhuman, and instead of human inhuman, I'm using the notion of the inhuman or the non-human. So, what does the analogy here consist in? It is my claim that Haraway's cyborg is this radical construction. It's about radical constructedness, and this radical constructedness as the determination in the last instance of the human is a stance or the instance of the real in some way. My claim is that there is some sort of realism there, some sort of realism not of the metaphysical kind, but the or the old metaphysical kind, but rather one which goes beyond the constraints of postmodernism and post-structuralism. So in a way, a realism which could be compared, still not reduced to the concepts, different concepts of the real we can find in non-philosophy, in speculative realism, whatever that is. It's a rather heterogeneous thing. To be honest, the only part of it which is relevant for my work is real and non-philosophy. And in fact, I don't know much about the rest of speculative realism, and especially not much, if anything, on object-oriented ontology. So going back to Haraway and the cyborg. So in my view, okay, let's not compare it to the real and speculative realism, the non-philosophy, perhaps something similar to Althusser's determination in the last instance, perhaps similar to the status of the real in Marx. And we will be talking a lot about that. I will try to demonstrate that the use of the concept of the real is key in Marx, not material. He actually avoids the concept of material and materialism as a philosophical concept, and he very often resorts to the real or the bodily, the physical, and the sensuous. So, anyway, the cyborg, or this radical constructedness as the determination in the last instance of the cyborg, is something which I'm treating here as representing or containing the status of the real. Let's put it this way: it holds the position of the real if we look at it from a Lacanian perspective. So that is the claim, and this radical deed is the claim about the radical constructedness, and we're not looking at the split as something which could be overcome, as something with regard to which we can create a certain, romantic nihilist perspective, observing and, being fascinated by this constitutive void or the constitutive split. No. It's not the split that is fascinating us. It's not the fissure. It's not this philosophical. It's not about this philosophical romanticism, which is in fact romanticism. It is on the quite to the contrary, the radical constructiveness, the radical hybrid we should be concerned with, if we are to move beyond the self-sufficiency of philosophy. Okay, so the rest is just certain quotes from what I will be reading here, which I thought might encapsulate some of the main points. Just one or two are my quotes, the rest is from Marx. Okay, so I think I presented most of the first pages, but okay. If it's too long, just stop. How much time do I have? Oh, okay, so there is enough text for that amount of time. Okay. So, the diet, technology, the animal, and the inhuman. Yeah, I did not present the animal here, which is actually the one of the components of the diet. The constitutive ones, but we'll arrive to that. So, the radicalized diet of technology and the organic, which I will term the human-inhuman, I presented this notion already, human-inhuman, resorting to the terminology of non-standard philosophy. Actually, this is the new term Lorwell uses. He is not referring any longer to non-philosophy, but rather to non-standard philosophy. Although, if you want to establish a distinction between his more recent works and the older ones, you can use non-philosophy when referring to the publications prior to 2010, I think. So the radicalized idea of technology and the organic, which I will term the human in human, resorting to the terminology of non-standard philosophy, homologous to and drawing on the idea of the cyborg, Haraway, cannot be reduced to a meaning or truth. So this means it is, in the last instance, real. It evades the transcendental, the reduction to a truth or a meaning. So this radical kernel of the real cannot be reduced to a truth. We cannot say what it philosophically is or what it is in terms of a truth. It is the real. As in Lacan, the real evades truth or language. So this radical deed cannot be reduced to a meaning or truth. François Laruelle's human in human is neither physical nor transcendental or linguistic, but rather a radical hybrid of the two. In other words, the human in human, which is a cyborg, escapes philosophy or the reduction to a truth or of the real. So reduction to a truth of the real, in the sense that the real is never some kind of truth. As a real that pretends to be more real, perfect, than the real itself. So the real in philosophy is actually the real, which is in doubt with the pretension to be more real than the real itself. This is skipping through many pages of Laruelle, but presuming that you know them. Let me just quickly explain. According to him, he is very often criticized that he reduces the entire history of philosophy to one thing. He operates with the method of the determination in the last instance, which is inspired by Marx and Althusser. And so according to this determination in the last instance, he believes that the determining instance of all philosophy since Greek antiquity to nowadays, to contemporary philosophy, is this, he calls it amphibology between the real and thought, real and truth. This idea that there is a perfect equation between real and truth. Even we have this spontaneous minds, philosophical reasons, I assume all of us in this room who are in humanities, and I presume most of us are from the fields of humanities, of this automatic equation between the two. If you speak to a scientist, they do not, it seems that they do not establish spontaneously and automatically this equation between real and truth. Actually, they don't even operate with the concept of truth. It could be accurate, exact, or not exact, but truth. What is truth? Well, Laruelle claims that truth is this construction which appeared with the concept of the being in Greek philosophy that establishes this amphibology, as he calls it, between thought and the real. And he believes that this is what determines all philosophy. And he does not believe that he's too pretentious to define the entire history of philosophy, because he does not seem to believe that it has this status of universality, as many of us do. To him, it's just one phenomenon restrained to, referring to or determined by a certain context, which is Western, which is Greek and Judaic, as he calls it. So it's a cultural thing, according to him. It begins with Greece, goes through what he calls the Jewish tradition, meaning the influence of Christianity, and we arrive to nowadays. So anyway, it was this is another digression, but it's, I think, necessary to explain this context as well. The inhuman I'm talking about here cannot be reduced to truth in this sense. So by virtue of its determination in the last instance as a radical deed, the human inhuman is non-human, or it is inhuman in Haraway's sense. It is monstrous along with the animal, the machine, and the darkness of the out there. So the inhuman or the human without philosophy, that is my claim here, is inhuman or non-human. It is inhuman in the sense that it is monstrous along with the animal, the machine, and the darkness of the out there. So the human radical constructedness grounded in, although not reducible to, the binary of technology and the organic or nature, does not make it more rational, more intelligent, and less physical, less animal. So technology does not make this radical deed more rational and less animal. Quite to the contrary. Contrary, the kernel of the hybridity does not contain a purely technological or rational purpose. It is unruly, as meaningless, as merely material as the animal. The kernel of hybridity is the lived or the experienced without a subject. That is, the experiential or the pre-subjective taking place. The hybrid is, therefore, an instance of the real, which precedes language or the transcendental. It is inhuman, or put in Lorelian terms, it is non-human. So the first movement toward transforming it into a meaning, elevating it into a form which plays a role in an organized universe, which is philosophy, is a movement toward humanization, aligned with the Enlightenment project. The latter represents a metaphysical project consisting in secularized version of the theological-philosophical idea of humanism and the role of nature or reason in it. In other words, the non-philosophical approach to the idea of humanity and the role of technology in its constitution, regardless of whether conceptualized in terms of the classical humanist tradition or in the post-humanist one, is the necessary condition for transcending the anthropocentric naturalization of technology. So this idea of perfect automation and acceleration towards certain emancipation, serving the communist goal, according to me, is endowed with the naive anthropocentric naturalization of technology. It sounds paradoxical at the moment, but I will explain how come. So non-philosophy identifies the human or the non-human real as the identity in the last instance of being human or participating in the species being, as Marx would put it, of humanity. One of its first names is human, inhuman, a non-philosophical designation which refers to humanity without humanism, whose agency can also be called non-human, what I explained in the beginning, so let's not repeat it. So humanity is a theological-philosophical creation, and it is always naturalized. Thanks to philosophy and technology, nature is always humanized. Thanks to philosophy, including contemporary philosophy, including post-structuralist philosophy, including techno-optimistic philosophy. It is, nature is always humanized. As long as the technological component of the radical diet, so we're returning to the radical diet, as long as the technological component of the radical diet called the cyborg can be humanized, so the technological part, or transformed into pure transcendence, constituting the only accessible reality that is pure rationality, it is neither monstrous nor inhuman. It is again this enlightenment myth. If we elevate the technological or rational part of the radical diet to some pure rationality which governs the hybrid, and we reduce the irrational aspect of it, the organic or the animal, to irrelevant, we are again returning to the old Enlightenment myth of rationality, and hence the technological aspect of the diet is elevated to some sort of a humanist myth again. So if we see it in that way, and my claim is also that in Donna Haraway, I don't know if we will have the time to arrive to those elaborations, that in Donna Haraway we can speak of this radical diet, of the radical hybridity, in which there is no reconciliation between the two, and certainly not one in terms of the rationalist project. Quite to the contrary, if there is hierarchy between the two components, if there is at all any, in Haraway, it means that it seems, no, it doesn't seem so. And every accurate reading will lead us to that conclusion. The underpinning or the determining aspect of the diet is the animal, actually, in Haraway, not technology. So it's the other way around. If we have the time, we will arrive to those parts of the Cyborg Manifesto where we can clearly read these claims. So, if we see or construe this radical diet as ultimately determined by, or in the last instance determined by the transcendental, by the technological, by reason, as I said, it would be, the diet would be neither monstrous nor non-human, therefore not inhuman. It is. It will not be post-human either. It will be profoundly humanist. As a consequence, if it is humanist, it will also be naturalized. And naturalization, as you can notice, is a philosophical procedure in me. And it's sort of clear, I guess, by the term itself. So, the rationalist mind, determined by its anthropocentrism, in the last instance, will unavoidably mimic and reproduce nature. Therefore, in spite of the commitment to hybridization, it will never be inhuman or monstrous, if it's seen as, if it's reduced to technology and reason in the last instance. So the inhuman is that which escapes rational conceptualization, that which has no meaning or reason for existence. It is senseless, it is brute existence, mere matter, regardless of whether organic or artificially produced. The technological extension and the biological body are both alien to subjectivity, which is essentially and unavoidably a philosophical creation. Subjectivity is a philosophical creation. In other words, subjectivity is always already philosophical. It is nothing but the automaton of signification, which represents the human or constitutes it as representation. What makes it what makes in non in a non-human what makes the non-human is precisely its failure to fully represent. Some word is missing here. But it's clear, I think. So, technology precedes subjectivity. So this is my claim. And this is, I don't know what Luciana was speaking of, but I know how she understands the notion of the automaton. Maybe you can notice some divergence here with regard to the concept of automation. So, technology precedes subjectivity. It is my claim that we cannot ontologize technology. And we should not, because we will be entrapped once again in the philosophical dream of self-sufficiency, and that it's a contradiction in terms to reduce technology to ontology or to anything philosophical. Technology is what makes thought radically different from philosophical thinking. And technology is therefore techne, according to me. So technology precedes subjectivity just as the body does. It cannot therefore have an ontological status. It is pre-philosophical. It precedes it, it precedes philosophy, as techne, precedes philosophia. It is the real vis-à-vis the subject of language. The subject is always subject of language. And techne always precedes it. So, the hybridization of the two constitutes a category of society or the species being of humanity. Perfecting the imperfect nature, now, we're arriving to Slavcha's favorite topic, accelerationism. And yeah, this is where I see a philosophical problem there as well. It's first of all, the gesture of ontologization of technology, which I already problematized. And the second aspect is that it spontaneously drags with it an old philosophical dream, which does not seem to me is a progress of thought in any way. It's atavistic, according to me. So it seems that the myth that is driving this dream beneath the whole project is this idea of perfecting the imperfect nature. So, perfecting the imperfect nature because it is irrational cannot be the purpose or the idea of technology. Since the idea that nature contains meaning or sense, a certain causa finalis is theological and philosophical. And technology does not pursue this dream. So, perfecting the imperfect nature because it is irrational cannot be the purpose of technology. That is the point. Since the idea that nature contains meaning or sense is theological or philosophical. In order for something to be susceptible to perfecting, it should contain the tendency to be perfect. Minimally, it should be grounded in the possibility to constitute a meaning, a purpose. It should contain a telos. It should be a theological category. A Marxist position with regard to technology is necessarily a non-philosophical one. That is my claim, because it's a post-philosophical one. That is why the Marxist science does not envisage an ontological status for technology. According to the historical and materialist materials without philosophical materialism, science of Marxism, technology is a function of the social reproduction of the species being. Technology represents one of the two constituents of the radical deity we talked about in the beginning, or the non-human deity, as the determination and the last instance of humanity. As it is a social function, it does not constitute an ontological substance. In metaphysical terms, it is not ousia, it is not ousia, but rather something closer to tropos, or mode, modality. That is why, in the last instance, technology is prosthesis of the organic. Later on, I support this claim with Shulam et Firestone's work and Harawi's work also. I am announcing all this stuff because I'm sure we will not arrive to that point of the paper. That is why, in the last instance, technology is prosthesis. Together, they represent a non-hierarchically constructed radical or dialectically insolvable. Radical is also used in the sense of dialectically insolvable duality as the determination of the species being, that is humanity. Contemporary capitalism is enabled by the absolute rule of pure speculation over the inhuman or the non-human kernel, not just the physical. However, the organic or the physical is the component of the inhuman binary that is fully objectivized and unilaterally exploited with technological means, or the bodily is subject to this exploitation. It is exploited by the automated capitalist speculation by means of technology, rather than by technology itself. It also alienates the technological from the species being in order to exert violent exploitation of the physical in the form of resource. The physical is reduced to resource, either as labor force or as mere material to be used in industrial mass production. Let me note that the technological progress, which was supposed to liberate us from wage labor, is moving in the following direction. What is automated are actually the highly skilled professions that one would have to pay with high salaries, and the pure physical labor, the more basic manual labor, is becoming, in fact, increasingly more manual because it's cheaper. So it seems that, you know, the technological progress in capitalism follows this direction, not an emancipatory dream. This is why we have all these sweatshops. And this is why we have forms of labor that have never existed in the past, which are similar to, slavery in ancient times. Actually, there are slave farms as well nowadays. There is even an abolitionist movement, unbelievable. So the realization of the automated reason, realization in the sense of turning into real, of the automated reason is surplus value. And in a more optimistic variant, simply value. In other words, its realization is yet another category of the specular, that is of value. Specular equals value. The speculative automated reason is essentially philosophical and exploitative of the of the physical or the organic, regardless whether naturally created or synthetic. And this is where I establish a perfect analogy between philosophy and capitalism. So it does not have existence outside the self-enveloped and philosophically determined reality of the speculative mind or the automation out of joint. So, alienation of labor through abstraction. We are arriving to Marx. This is a quote from The Capital, where Marx says, the value of commodity is the very opposite of the coarse materiality of their substance. Not an atom of matter enters into its composition. So, capitalism, it's not about materialism or materiality or physicality. Even Marx claimed that, at least this quote proves that. So, Marx unmasks the complete lack of materiality as the condition for determination in the last instance of commodity qua commodity. The product of human labor assumes the status of commodity only when it is absolutely detached from its physicality. And this is a quote from Marx, Capital, Volume 1. I think it's the bit on fetishism. So he says the following. There is a physical relation between physical things, but it is different with commodities. So commodities are not physical things. They're these speculative constructions of even philosophical construction. And it is my claim that he also equates philosophy and capitalism. This is why he attempts to move beyond philosophy. And I see it as the worst possible crime, the entire history of Marxism as subsequent philosophization of Marx, beginning with Lenin. So there is a physical relation between physical things, but it is different with commodities. There, the existence of things qua commodities and the value relation between the products of labor, which stamps them as commodities, have absolutely no connection with their physical properties and with the material relations arising. This is the part of Capital, Volume 1, where he actually defines and explains commodity. The production and exchange of commodities is grounded in an estrangement from the physical. The estrangement first takes place in the form of the exploitation of human labor as physicality. And in a second gesture, by way of entering the endless or circular change of exchange of human of exchange of values, it assumes the status of commodity. The second gesture would not be possible without the first. There is direct causal relation between the two. Abstraction from the physical and its specular recreation as a sign, a value, ergo a commodity, is the determination in the last instance of capitalism and philosophy. Such gesture of abstraction is fundamentally political. And this is where I need to clarify this. I have had debates with friends, colleagues, for example, with Brassier, and he says a problem here with, you know, the critique of abstraction. First of all, the critique of abstraction is subject to Marx's critique. Second of all, Marx never talks of abstraction as a cognitive faculty, but rather as a political gesture, the process we have been explaining all along here. So it is fundamentally political. It is a sovereign's act of instituting a law and a reality stemming from that law. It is an act of, so in short, I refer, as Marx did previously, to the legislating function of abstraction, not the cognitive faculty itself. So in capitalism, the latter has been extended into a plane of metaphysics and transformed into an ideological instrument. It has thus been recreated according to philosophy and can no longer be theoretically or scientifically approached according to the norms of cognitive science, in particular psychology. So I will skip some parts here. Okay, we'll skip this one, and I explained about tone or being and its status or the way it's critiqued in non-philosophy. So going back to abstraction as the procedure which is grounding of capitalism, according to Marx, and which is subject to his critique. So abstraction is the determination and the last instance of all commodities, abstraction from the physical, and of the circulation of commodity as pure value or surplus value, is enabled by the exploitation of human labor, which in its turn is always physical. It's interesting here that although Marx avoids the concept of matter or the material and resorts to the real, as I said, at one point here he seems to determine the real or consider the real as determined by the physical. And the last is still the physical is something else from the material. So the mystical character, he says, this is from also Capital, volume one. The mystical character of commodities does not originate, therefore, in their use value. Just as little does it proceed from the nature of the determining factors of value. For, in the first place, however varied the usual kinds of labor or productive activities may be, it is a physiological fact that there are functions of the human organism and that each such function, whatever may be its nature or form, is essentially the expenditure of human brain, nerves, muscles. End of quote. It seems that exploitation is in essence and unavoidably fetishistic, in the sense used by Marx in the first volume of The Capital, insofar as it is the effect of abstraction directed against the physical. Immediate needs that are expressed in and satisfied through the so-called use value of a product are in the last instance physical, including when they primarily concern the mind. Only if these physical needs are sacrificed and if they become subject to the holocaust of speculation, economic but also philosophical, is commodity created and with it the possibility of surplus value. A close reading of most of Marx's seminal texts disclose a repeated and consistent stance according to which exploitation is always already carried out by the speculative and the abstract against the physical, or the real or the material. This argument constitutes the core of his critique of fetishism. It is also, I will argue, the grounding epistemic position of his entire oeuvre, according to me. All questions that do not depart from the real of existence or simply from the lived are ill-posed and lead towards speculation based on the procedure of abstraction that he problematizes. Here is a quote from this one. So he says the following: your question is itself a product of abstraction. This is from it's not from, it seems like it's from Feuerbach, the thesis on Feuerbach, but it's not. It's from the economic philosophical manuscripts of 1844. So he says the following: your question is itself a product of abstraction. Ask yourself how you arrived at that question. Ask yourself whether your question is not posed from a standpoint to which I cannot reply, because it is wrongly put. And it is wrongly put because it's put from the standpoint of abstraction. It is a product of abstraction. So it is evident that Marx problematizes this, and he sees this as the key problem. I do not understand any form of reading Marx which would argue the opposite. I mean, anybody can argue the opposite, but that will not be a reading of Marx. It will be correcting of Marx. Ask yourself how you arrived at that question. Ask yourself whether your question is not posed from a standpoint to which I cannot reply, because it is wrongly put. Ask yourself whether that progress as such exists for a reasonable mind. When you ask about the creation of nature and man, you are abstracting, in so doing, from man and nature. You postulate them as non-existent, and yet you want me to prove them to you as existent. This is a philosophical procedure par excellence. A philosophical mind behaves as if they did not exist, and when it demands the proof of their existence or how they coexist, it requires the creation of the two, as if as ex nihilo. This is this Promethean move, and he claims we should do the opposite. We should depart from the existent, from the real. Now, it is a very challenging task epistemologically to depart from this realist position, from this position where you are situated in the last instance in what is existent and what is experienced as immediate reality, and still carry out a cognitive procedure, which also includes the procedure of abstraction, in order to create a certain truth or explanation. But this is another topic and a long one. Still, his claim is this: a realist mind or a Marxist reason departs from such a position. We do not assume that they are not existent, and then we recreate a certain myth of their coming to being. Quite to the contrary, the thought should be informed by the reality of their existence, and then proceed with reasoning of it, about it. As I said, it's quite a different topic and an epistemological one. We cannot go into that, but I will say the following: that what Marx did with Capital, and his analysis of capitalism, the economic system of capitalism, is the philosophical, humanist, political consequences we have from this analysis is already some sort of demonstration how that type of reason works. His own work is demonstration of this possibility, theoretical or scientific possibility. So, when ask yourself whether when you ask about the creation of nature and man, you're abstracting in so doing from man and nature. You postulate them as non-existent, and yet you want me to prove them to you as existing. Now I say to you, give up your abstraction, and you will also give up your question. The material that Marx invokes as the authority in the last instance of every operation of thought which seeks to establish accurate knowledge of reality is material insofar as it is physical, sensuous, and real. These are the concepts of the namings of the real he operates with. As I said in the beginning, he does not operate with material or materialism. It is unequivocally stated so in his first thesis on Feuerbach. He says, the chief defect of all hitherto existing materialism, that of Feuerbach included, is that the thing, reality, sensuousness, is conceived only in the form of the object So it's conceived only in the form of object, of the object. This is important. So it's not a thing, it's the object. And that there is the problem. Or of contemplation. but not as a sensuous human activity, practice, or not subjectively. Hence, in contradistinction to materialism, the active side was developed abstractly by idealism, which of course does not know real sensuous activity as such. Human activity, particularly human subjectivity, is not reducible to physical activity. In the above quote, Marx resorts to such terms as the thing, reality, and practice as different names for the same referent. Physicality only vouches for that the object of cognition is not an abstraction, that it is anchored in the real. So, Marx's realism and the status of materialism in it. Maybe we can skip this part. And the one of false consciousness. Yeah. Okay, we'll arrive to Laruelle now. And we'll skip some parts and come to the, if there is time, to the feminist part. If not, we can tackle it during the discussion. So, a socialist reappropriation of alienation, the real of joy and suffering in the grounding split. So my claim here and in the book from which I sent you some chapters is that we in fact cannot move beyond metaphysics. We can move beyond philosophy, but not beyond metaphysics. So metaphysics is indispensable. And there can be only a socialist or feminist reappropriation, reconceptualization of metaphysics. Metaphysics is the term I use to describe those operations which are at the heart of the grounding alienation with regard to the creation of subjectivity. And it is my claim that this alienation should be reclaimed, owned, and including the reality of its trauma, and that this would be a founding socialist and feminist procedure. So this is some sort of indispensable intro in order to follow the rest of not the entire presentation, but what I will manage to present. So in non-philosophy, enjoyment and suffering do not establish opposition. That is what Laruelle inherits from Lacan, in fact. They are both instances of the lived, le vécu in French, in his own original terms, of the sheer experience that takes place as suffering in the etymological sense of the Latin word. One is one is subjected to a sensation, be it pleasure or pain, which takes place in the defenseless body through the instance of pure exposure and vulnerability. Similarly, Laruelle's the lived, le vécu, is called le joui, regardless of whether it is the product of the infliction of pain or pleasure. About le joui, he says, it is, this is my translation from the French. I think that the book is now published in English. It's from Théorie des étrangers, Theory of Strangers. I think that it's already published in English, but I'm not sure. So, it is the undivided of pain, yet not determined by it, le joui. As the undivided lived of joy, but never their synthesis, not even immanent. The unilateral mute instance of the lived in Marx's text is called suffering, regardless of whether it is the result of violence or a sensation of pleasure. So in Private Property and Communism. we find this quote. The object is the manifestation of human reality. It is human activity and human suffering. For suffering, humanely considered, is a kind of self-enjoyment of man. This is Marx. Suffering is self-enjoyment, not because of some vague masochistic inclination, but because it represents a sublimated alienation to which the self belongs intimately. So this is the metaphysics I would like to reclaim that I explained in the beginning. So this self-enjoyment is the sublimated alienation to which the self belongs intimately. Pain situates us in the real of ourselves. The real is the instance one inhabits prior to any making sense out of it. As anteriority vis-à-vis language, it precedes any possibility of abstraction, including that of abstract activity and a belly, as Marx puts it. Laurel's jouissance is one of the first names, as he calls it, of the real that we all are in the last instance. So, in the thesis on Feuerbach, Marx argues for a materialism that is not the product of an idea one can find in history of philosophy. So, if we can speak of any materialism in Marx, it's not one which can we can find in history of philosophy, or neither it is one which we should construe as part of history of philosophy. In fact, if the claim is that he is post-philosophical or non-philosophical. Let me just add one footnote that, for example, Laruelle and his project of non-philosophy, he claims that it is inspired by Marx, that he would not have arrived to the project of non-philosophy without Marx. He thought that he was following Marx's project with a stance of heresy, because this is what he always does, but in spite of this heresy, a certain position of fidelity to the project. So it's not like, you know, it's some sort of a very compatible combination to put Marx and Laurel together. So materialism is merely a form of realism for Marx. He argues for it insofar as it departs from the thing, as he calls it, and the sensuous human activity practice. The antithesis between matter and idea here is also one imposed by abstract or philosophical contemplation. The goal of humanity then, according to Marx, should be emancipation from all forms of oppression and subjugation. This depends on the abolishment of antithesis established between the abstract or false consciousness. It can be, although Marx never actually uses the phrase itself, it can be accomplished by rooting thought in practice or the real. So this is another quote from Marx. It's from Private Property and Communism, from the Economic and Philosophical Manuscripts, and he says, we see how subjectivity and objectivity, spirituality and materiality, activity and suffering lose their antithetical character, and thus their existence as such antithesis only within the framework of society. We see how the resolution of the theoretical antithesis is only possible in a practical way, by virtue of the practical energy of man. Their resolution is therefore by no means merely a problem of understanding. So it cannot be a product of dialectics, this resolution, but a real problem of life. He uses the word real, but the real problem of life, which philosophy could not solve precisely because it conceived this problem as merely theoretical one. The chief concern of Marxism is ensuring realism rather than materialism. So, a socialist reappropriation of alienation, we are coming to the metaphysical part, and Okay, we read this part. Maybe, okay, let's finish actually this one. So, the invasion of sensation, whether undergone as pain or pleasure, is suffering since it and entails unmitigated exposure. This is the part we read, I think. So, according to Laruelle's non-standard psychoanalysis, operating with transcendental material of Lacan's psychoanalysis, as he would put it, the instance of the stranger or the process of estrangement is pre-subjectivization. And it is unavoidable and necessary in order to mediate the traumatic immediacy of the real. So in this sense, they agree with Lacan. This unmediated immediacy of the real must be mitigated in some way. Otherwise, it would be traumatic. So he creates the instance of the stranger as the initial gesture of this construction, which can move towards subjectivity, although subjectivity would be a philosophical term, I insist. So Laruelle says the strangers are radical subjectivities, similarly to the radical diet, rather than persons, individuals, or subjects in the technical, transcendental sense of the word. Laruelle's stranger is made of transcendental material, as he puts it, since it is a form of subjectivity or the product of language, regardless of how transcendentally minimal. Nonetheless, it also is radical since it is experienced as a point of exteriority at the heart of the real. Unlike Lacan's barred subject, the radical subjectivity as stranger, as defined by Laruelle, possesses a concrete body or flesh, one consisting of the multitudes of transcendental material. Thus, the experience of estrangement, which is in an instance of suffering that takes place through the real that we are, must not be erased through a double abstraction. That is, an abstraction of and alienation from the pre-subjective and the founding experience of estrangement. So we have a procedure of double abstraction. The founding abstraction of the constitution of the subject or the self, or let's use the metaphor of the stranger. This is why Laruelle uses this metaphor of the stranger in order to avoid philosophization of this instance. So this founding alienation is erased in a double, in a second gesture of philosophical reason or capitalist reason. And it is this the source of this need, necessity, to fill this grounding void with signification, with value, with exuberance of presence of materiality, which is in fact commodity. So the process of alienation from the immediacy of the real through the instance of the stranger or radical subjectivity introduces the trauma of the founding split. The pain of the unavoidable split is inalienable. It takes place in or as the real. The idea is that this founding estrangement has always been there, but we have had the neurotic subject since we have had capitalism. So it recognizes as a diet that is constituted by thought's unilateral position with respect to the real and by the indifferent to thought unilaterality of the real. And if this diet is radically determined as such, the instance of alienation remains an exteriority. To radically determine the diet as such and think it as its and its constitutive elements in terms of this radicalization is to perform an act of dualysis, as Laruelle calls it, which is the founding methodological procedure of non-philosophy or of non-standard philosophy. In that way, thought is not collapsed into and surreptitiously identified with the real of the pain that is caused by the experience of auto-alienation as the primordial split. Dualis's in Laruelle's own terminology is a procedure of unilateral affirmation of the diet. The non-abstractionist or non-philosophical recognition of the grounding alienation of the self is radical. That is, it does not introduce a philosophical double of the reality of alienation that would constitute a modern subjectivity. Okay, we have 3 more minutes. I can skip some bits here. We have 15 more. Okay. Okay. So we can move to finance capitalism and automation in finance capitalism, or the automation of the production of value. So according to Marx in volume 3 of Capital, the inherent laws of the capitalist political and economic order will nourish and exacerbate the contradiction between pure speculation and the primary mode of operation of capitalism and the material it aims to control and exploit. Speculation is product of representation or of value, including both surplus and use value, whereby the latter, use value, insofar as value and estimation rather than the practice of use, is just a derivative of surplus value. Okay, this is not what Marx says, this is what I say. So, value is always surplus value, I claim. And even when anchored in the practice of use, the automation of signification, value creation, is unstoppable. So I'm talking here about the automaton in Lacanian sense, in a structuralist linguistic sense, this automation of language or automatism of language. So automation of signification, as in Lacan's automaton. And in linguistics in general. So the automation of signification, value creation, is unstoppable in the capitalist or neurotic subject and in capitalism as value, constant value production. So here is the perfect analogy. So the automaton of signification, value creation, is unstoppable and self-sufficient, whereas the intervention of the real or the mere material is an intrusion of the senseless into the automated production of sense, that is value. As raw materials are intervention of the senseless, the perfect automation of stock exchange, for example. So I'm talking about this split. They're practically raw materials, oil even, are irrelevant unless translated into a value that mathematically operates up there in the system of stock exchange. So the automation of signification value creation is unstoppable and self-sufficient, whereas the intervention of the real is an intrusion of the senseless into the automated production of sense, that is of value. Speculation out of joint will assume a life of its own, detached from the material possession of capital as private property or as simply having actual money. And it is so. You don't have to have actual money, actually, to produce value on the stock exchange. This is what the crisis in 2008 was about. So speculative capital, the capital with which the finance industry operates today, is potential money. It is pure speculation. Contemporary finance capital, or the so-called finance industry relies and profits from the operations of circulation as a process per se and as tautology, divorced from any grounding in the material basis of capital. The capital of contemporary finance industry has been information, knowledge, and political power. I claim political power. I don't know if there will be time to elaborate on this, but my claim, and it is not just my claim, you can read it in David Harvey's work, for example, my claim is that there is nothing natural or spontaneous in the way neoliberal capitalism and finance industry has been developing in the last decades. Quite to the contrary, such a project could be enabled only politically. To believe that there is something spontaneous and natural about it is to, in fact, believe in the old capitalist naive dream about naturalness of how capitalist economy functions. What I have been explaining up until now is that there is nothing natural about it. It is something which is contrary to nature, in fact. And if it believes that it simulates nature, it is a philosophical belief, philosophical theological belief of its own. So the capital of contemporary finance industry has been information, knowledge, and political power. About I explained about political power, about information and knowledge. I guess you all know already. I mean, the crisis in 2008 occurred because there were not in fact such investments, not just in real estate, in material property, but also even in capital. The hedge funds did not operate with actual capital that could vouch for the operations they undertook. So what they operated with was were the estimations, how the value will move, what they will profit from, what they will not profit from, and also manipulate with what should bring about profit. Of course, that project failed. That is why the banks were bailed out. And that project of sophisticated speculation had to be bailed out by bare, brute materiality of depriving people from households, depriving people from homes. So it was a shipwreck of sophisticated speculation against primitive materiality of human suffering, of defaulted houses, mortgages, and lost homes of poverty and deprivation. So there we go. So according to Marx, such a development is necessary. He says this in the third volume of Capital. He says, he calls it the credit system when he envisages the development of finance industry. He uses the term credit system. So according to Marx, such a development is necessary and inevitable in the last stage of capitalism, that's what he says, producing a new financial aristocracy, I'm quoting him now, producing a new financial aristocracy, a new variety of parasites in the shape of promoters, speculators, and simply nominal directors. A whole system of swindling and cheating, I'm really quoting him, and cheating by means of corporation promotion, stock insurance, and stock speculation. It is private production without the control of private property. It's unbelievable. So this stage is, he says, the last stage. So it would be the metastatic stage for capitalism. Ensuing, so this is the reason which we should be feeling, hopeful about the stage we're in. It's the metastatic, phase of capitalism issuing into the greatest and most productive contradiction that should lead to its self-dissolution. What our contemporary media and corporate political powers call crisis seems to be, by all of its constitutive characteristic, the final stage of capitalism, which Marx describes as self-dissolving. It unveils the reality of economic production and social and technological progress as unfolding virtually independently from the material basis. The acceleration process, which is bound to happen, so the acceleration process, Marx says, is bound to happen by the very laws of capital. So we do not need to accelerate anything. So the acceleration process, which is bound to happen through what Marx called the credit system, the ever-growing distance between actual playing and buying of a commodity, and the possibility of an ever-expanding intermission of the credit period, divulges the spectrality of capital, money, and private property. Acceleration through the credit system as the final stage of capitalism is announced and elaborated, as I said, in Volume 3, Chapter 5 of Capital. As the US government report on the 2008 financial crisis shows, Wall Street CEOs do not have to invest any real or actual private property. And practically no capital of theirs has to be invested in order to initiate, manage, and profit. Quite to the contrary, it is the private property of the poor that has been invested and then defaulted as the post-2007 crisis occurred. By no material investment of one's own investment, industrialists of the finance industry create an unstoppable growing capital that enables them and the government to control the society as the highest form of political economic power. The illusion of capital's materiality and material property serving as the basis for an economy has become apparent through the financial speculation whose final form has come down to sheer swindling, albeit aiming at pure profit and exploitation of the poor only. The crisis has also unwittingly so shown that the emperor has been naked for quite some time. The capital as the material and real basis of economic process is a mirage. On the basis of this particular contradiction, the stock exchange managers, as Marx called them, have managed to amass most of the material resources for themselves. Acceleration is imminent to capitalism. Capitalism is unstoppably accelerated by the inherent laws of speculation itself, and therefore that of dematerialization. On the one hand, so this is a quote from Marx, from Capital, Volume 3, and he has something to say on acceleration. So on the one hand, the acceleration is technical. For example, this is Marx, for example, with the same magnitude and number of actual turnovers of commodities for consumption, a smaller quantity of money or money tokens performs the same service. This is bound up with the technique of banking. On the other hand, credit accelerates the velocity of the metamorphosis of commodities and thereby the velocity of money circulation. Acceleration by means of credit of the individual phases of capital, and with it an acceleration of the process of reproduction in general. On the other hand, credit helps to keep the acts of buying and selling apart longer and serves thereby as basis for speculation. Contraction of reserve funds may be viewed in two ways: as a reproduction of the circulating medium on the one hand, and on the other as a reduction of the part of capital which must always exist in the form of money. Acceleration does not take place in the form of finance capital only, but also in the area of material production, of technological, militaristic development. The unstoppable development of the means of production, which is also the means of exploitation of the human and animal species is constantly accelerated. It's called technological development. Technological development is subject to private property. Its goal is the creation of surplus value. Current technological development, contemporary. Inventions are in the possession of capitalist oligarchs exclusively. The imagined political revolution via technological acceleration requires a reversed model of ownership and reinvention of the social role of technological development. In order to achieve these goals, following the model of associations of producers advocated by Marx, the technological process should be appropriated by the actual producers. So, in order to have this emancipatory result of technological acceleration, we must first have this reversal of ownership. As a consequence, this will lead to a replacement of the spectrality and superfluity of capital by real and tangible social reproduction. In what Marx announces as the late stage of capitalism, in finance capitalism, the process of signification is merely carried out through mere swindling. In this process, the private ownership of property has been proven to be just ownership, as Marx predicted, as mere instance of the material that to be exploited by the stock exchange managers. As the essentially speculative nature of capitalist economy has accelerated, the central contradiction has moved to an extreme. According to Marx, the contradiction taken in extremis must be resolved by self-dissolving the impossible, unsustainable, contradicting couple. In the of the contradiction, if it culminates, if it exacerbates the fissure with the real and the physical that it introduced in principio, it will founder the, as the real starts to act on its own, escaping the control of philosophy or capitalism. It's the same. Unruly as it is, thanks to its brutal physical force and or the force of the real, which can include material actions carried out by inanimate agencies, it will disperse the ruling webs of meaning or the existing universe consisting of estimation of values. Such a process would lead to the self-dissolution of the founding binary of capitalism because the reality is constituted by, grounded in, and conditioned by social process rather than capital investment. Materiality of contemporary reality lies in society in its physicality and effects of a contradicting real rather than in the symbolism of money. The part about the women and the animal is the one I skipped when I stumbled across suffering as pleasure, but we can talk about that during the discussion. It's basically something that refers to the status of animality, mere physicality, and the fact that what is overlooked in women's emancipation through socialism or communism is something which is also biologically or physically determined, but we can go into that during the discussion. So,
thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.